Keep some restraint on your behavior. Live a balanced life. So when we live in the world, we have to understand that this world, as I mentioned before, is not for our upabhog. It's for our upyog. Upabhog means indulging in trying to get the most happiness possible out of this world in every way. That's not what the world was meant for. If we live life like that, we get a physical punishment. We end up being ill because we don't treat our body properly. Upayog means we're making use of just what we need in order to get by. In fact, there's a statement of Veda Vyasji in the Bhagavatam. Krishna's telling us in Gita, we have to live a balanced life in the world. Naradji is telling us we have to live a balanced life in the world. And Veda Vyasji is telling us in the Bhagavatam. Yavad bhrit jatharam tavat svatvam hi dehinam adhikam yo bhimanyet saste no dandamarhati. Veda Vyasji says, you know how much right you have to own in this world? Jatharam yavat svatvam hi dehinam. Just enough to fill your belly. Just enough to get by. He says that's how much you have a right to. Adhikam yobhimanyeta. If we try to hoard more for our upabhog, then in the eyes of karma, in the eyes of the spiritual government, we'll be treated as a thief. And we'll get such a destiny in our next life as a thief would get. So this is how we should approach our life in the world. Now this doesn't mean, you see, someone may think, does that mean I should just leave the world and go to the jungle? In fact, leaving the world and going to the jungle is neither here nor there. No, we don't have to leave the world and go to the jungle. Because the point is to attach our mind to God. It doesn't matter if we're in the jungle or in the world. It doesn't matter if someone is a grihasthi or a sannyasi. The point is, love God. So you can attach your mind to God no matter where you are in this world. Even if you're in the jungle, you're still in the world. Even if you could be in the jungle and lovingly remembering the life you used to have in the world, then what's the point of that? You might as well still be in the world. So just leaving physically and going to the jungle doesn't guarantee that your mind is going to get attached to God. What guarantees that is if we gain correct knowledge of why we should attach our mind to God, and then we implement that into our daily life. So we don't have to leave our prior commitments. If someone is already committed to family life, they can continue with that life and just add in this understanding about how to attach their mind to God and implement that while living physically in the world, while performing all their worldly duties. Because duty is performed with the physical body and bhakti is done with the mind. So you can love God and physically do your duties in the world. Someone might wonder though, my duty towards my family, how will that be affected if I become less attached to them? This is a common question, a common fear people have, that if I'm not attached to my family, how will I do my duty? So the root of this question is a confusion that attachment actually helps us do our duty. In fact, it's the opposite. At its root, attachment is selfish. Because why do we get attached to someone? We think, I'm going to get happiness from this person. That's why we get attached to them. If we didn't have a hope of getting happiness, like let's say you have a neighbor, and he's been your neighbor for 3-4 years. You're not attached to him in any way, he's just a casual acquaintance. But then it turns out, oh, it seems like he might be useful to help me in my business. Then automatically you start thinking more favorably about that person. As soon as there's a hope, then we start developing an attachment. So all of our attachments, even to our closest people in this world, the adhar, the foundation for that attachment is swarth. It's a selfish desire, which is natural. Don't think that I'm condemning you. This is not a bad thing. This is the natural way the human mind works. The human mind seeks happiness all the time, everywhere, and will continue to do that until we attain God. So it's quite natural to look for happiness from other people. But there are two problems with that. Number one, when that person isn't God-realized, it means that person doesn't have perfect happiness. So how are they going to give it to me? I'm putting my hope in the wrong place. I should have my hope in the right place. God is happiness. He can actually give me happiness. If I attach my mind to any worldly person, they can't give me what they don't have. It's like one beggar begging from another beggar. They're having hope from me and I'm having hope from them, and neither of us can give the other one perfect happiness. Perfect happiness must come from God. So then it leads to disappointments, and that's when we have frustration in our relationships, when we don't get what we want. But how can another person always behave the way we want or always give us what we want? It's an unfair expectation, and it leads to problems. It leads to arguments and disagreements in the family, at work, amongst our friends. And what is the root cause of this? Attachment. So the attachment is not helping us in any way. The attachment is getting in the way of our duty. See, duty means what? Doing what's best for the other person. That's duty. That's our duty to our children. So to whatever extent we're attached to our children, to that extent, we're unable to perform our duty. This may be the first time you've ever thought of family life in this way, so let me say it again. To whatever extent you're attached to your children, to that same extent, you're unable to perform your duty to them. How many times have we regretted things we said or things we did that we did emotionally? And that emotion came from the attachment. And later we look back and we say, oh, I made that person feel so badly. Maybe my own child, I made my child feel badly. I really reacted strongly. If I had had time to think about it instead of reacting, if I had waited until I had cooled down, I wouldn't have acted in such a way. So why did that happen? Because of our attachment. Oftentimes, someone from the outside can give us much better advice about our personal matters because they're not attached in the situation. They can see clearly. See, another word for attachment is moha. Moha means like an intoxication. The attachment clouds our intellect and doesn't allow us to discriminate properly what's the best thing to do in this situation. So instead of discriminating, we just react emotionally. So our ability to do our duty in our family is not dependent on our attachment, it's impeded by our attachment. Now, this is all just theory to you at this point, but I can share with you my own experience that even though before I came to this path I was not married, I did live a life in the world, I had a job. I noticed that I got better at all the things I had to do in the world as my worldly attachment decreased. And as I mentioned previously, I wasn't meditating on decreasing worldly attachments. I was just meditating on increasing my attachment to Krishna. And naturally, my worldly attachments started reducing and I felt the change internally. And although we're all afraid of letting go of those attachments, it's such a relief when they start reducing. You know, just like if someone is really intoxicated, he thinks, oh, I can drive fine.